You know, it's amazing how certain sounds bring back memories. Just like how they say smell is actually one of the most powerful things to invoke memories. And whenever I hear a lot of kids and stuff, it always reminds me of babies in a little town called Armenia. And because there was just tons of kids, and they didn't have nurses. And so the kids would be everywhere, and I loved the people's attitude towards it. There was no attitude, you know, and it was just, they would be running up and down the aisles, and nothing. Kids falling asleep on the concrete floor, seriously, and everything, and as I've shared before, open breastfeeding, you guys don't have to do that, and everything, but I love those memories in my mind, and that stuff does not distract me, so I encourage kids just to be kids, and just like God created you to be. So, Ephesians chapter 1, beginning verse 17. This is Paul praying. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, would give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you may know what is the hope of His calling, what are the glorious riches of His inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of His power to us who believe according to the working of His vast strength. Let's pray. Holy Father, as we open up the book of Ephesians in the next few weeks, we pray that we will be impacted by it, that it will just do a powerful God thing in our lives as your word just penetrates our hearts. We ask these things in your name. Amen. I used to work at a place called Dandy Oil in Drayton Valley with Randy. And I had spent 3 years running a skid steer. I grew up calling it a bobcat, but my boss at the seminary let me know bobcat is a name brand, and skid steer is the actual name of the tractor. What the product is called, and it's just like, it's not a Xerox machine, it's a copy machine. Xerox, you know you have arrived product-wise if your name of your product becomes the generic name for it, like Kleenex. It's not tissue, it's Kleenex, but Kleenex is a name brand, and everything. So maybe one day I'll invent a product that becomes true, but I knew how to run a skid steer and everything. At least I thought I did. And this one particular day, it was really, really dusty. And we swept the, can you turn down my mic some, Shirley? Thank you. Can everyone hear me still?
Yeah.
The guy that trained me, he would sweep it off with a long-handled broom and stuff. But we had one of those power sweepers in the back. And I'm going, come on, man. Let's work smarter, not harder. And this guy was like 30 years older than me, too. All right? And everything. So anyways, I go and I pop that thing on and I throw on the hydraulics and all this other stuff. And I'm out there and I'm sweeping away. At least I thought I was sweeping away. And everything. And it was looking pretty good and everything. And I was doing that for like 2 or 3 weeks. Then one day, I don't know if Randy or somebody came along, or it might have been Steve, that came along and he said, you know you're not doing that right. Well, I was looking behind me and I was sweeping, at least I thought I was, and everything. And he says, you know there's a power, there's a button in there that turns the sweeper on. not just that, but it turns the sweeper on and it pushes it in a bucket that you have to empty every now and then. And I think he said it sarcastic too. And you know, I thought I was doing a good job there, because as I was going forward, it was still pushing some of the dirt off. But the thing is that once I turned that sweeper on, oh my goodness, it was like a brand new day. You know, and it just started just going, and then I could reverse it too. I could take it either way, and everything. And I really liked getting. That's when I started getting truck drivers ticked off because I started throwing up dust and everything. And I was like, seriously, you're going to get upset about this. I know where you work. I drive out there. I know how muddy and nasty it is. You're going to get upset about this. But I realized that I could turn the sweeper on. I would turn the sweeper on and push all that dirt. And then every now and then I would have to go out to the debris pile in the back of the yard and dump the bucket and come back. And it started making sense because really after about 2 weeks of doing that, I started realizing I was having a residue pile coming, and it was just because the bucket was full. But you know what? I thought I knew how to run a bobcat. I thought I knew how to run that sweeper. I thought I grasped that. I thought I understood it. But you know what? As soon as someone gave me some real good facts about it, man, it became a brand new day. I began to have a firm grasp on how to run that piece of machinery. You know, I failed to grasp how to properly handle the power sweep, and thus was only experiencing a part of the full capacity of that machine. But before that, I thought I was cruising. I thought I had it. You know, sadly, the same is true, I believe, for so many Christians. It is true for so many Christians in their Christian walk in experiencing the full capacity of Christ. You know, the same with for me with my Christian walk the first few years. The first few years of my Christian walk, I was 17 when I came to know Christ for the first time. But I grew up in church and I knew the books of the Bible and everything. I could sing up here with the kids, which by the way, great job, kids. And everything, and I knew then I could tell you all about the cross. I could tell you what happened with the cross. I could tell you about baptism. I could tell you about Lord's Supper. I could tell you about the church. I could tell you about all that stuff. I thought I knew it. And even when I placed my faith and repented and placed my faith in Christ when I was 17, I still thought I knew it then. And I did. I was a believer. Christ had washed me clean, and I was made righteous in God's sight. But it wasn't until I was about 19 that God began to take me through about 2.5 years of exploration of His Word that I began to really understand my identity in Christ. Where I began to realize the full capacity of that power sweep. The full capacity of Christ in my life. Do you know that during that time there was a scripture He kept on giving to me over and over again? It's Jeremiah 29:13, where it says, "You shall seek me and find me when you seek for me with all your heart." Sadly, too many Christians are satisfied with the prayer they prayed many years ago, not realizing that two things. First, that prayer does nothing for them. That it's Jesus Christ that did something for them. And second, their salvation is not wrapped up in a prayer. And if that's your point, if that's your Christianity, my friend, you are missing out on so much. And now we come to the book of Ephesians. Because the book of Ephesians is like that power sweep for me. The book of Ephesians is 6 chapters of what I would call an owner's manual for your Christian walk so that you can understand and get a full grasp of your salvation. So that you can understand all the implications of Jesus Christ in your life. Amen. And not just the catchphrases that are still common in North American Christianity. And not just the prayer that you prayed one day. Don't get me wrong, even at the end of this message, I may ask you, invite you for the first time to ask Christ into your heart. But you better guarantee you also know, friend, there's something for me as well. I will not leave you there. Because if I do, I have failed you greatly. And this church better not leave you there as well. See, Paul didn't want to leave the Christians that he ministered to empty-handed either. He wanted them to experience the full brunt, to grasp their salvation. You know, it was when I finally understood that being a Christian was more than a prayer parade, but grasping the truth of what Christ has done, that I began to truly grasp my salvation and all that it entails. Sadly, As I have gone through my Christian walk, and especially since I have become a pastor, I have come to see that many people have failed to grasp the magnitude. That's the word I was looking for earlier. The magnitude of their salvation through Jesus Christ. This failure to have a firm grasp on the truths of what God has done in us and for us through Christ and His death and His resurrection has caused many to sit in churches, has caused many people to sit in churches defeated, bitter at God, going, where is this joy? Where is this peace? And the reason they're like that is because no one ever taught them that there was so much more. Others have become satisfied with just a prayer prayed a few years ago, or many years ago. Others have a casualness towards sin because they don't understand the full implications of Christ. Others are so overcome with shame from sin that God has already forgiven that they never move forward. And others just sit there on their pews and sit there and just smiling, and the only salvation they can think of is that I get to go to heaven. Not realizing heaven is just one piece of it all.
Amen.
It's just a portion. But yet the way we preach the gospel so much is like heaven is the end result and not God Himself. When we grasp the depth of our salvation that God has offered to us through His Son, Jesus Christ, we will experience, just as these verses that we just prayed, the full capacity of our salvation. We will experience the hope of our calling. We will experience the glorious riches of His inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of His power to those who believe. That is exactly why Paul wrote this letter. Now, there is a debate about the book of Ephesians among biblical authors about whether this book was written just to the church of Ephesus. The reason being is because depending upon what ancient manuscript in Greek that you read, some will say to the church in Ephesus. Some have just a blank. Seriously, there's just a blank. And so many people believe that actually the book of Ephesians was not just written to the church in Ephesus, but actually was a letter that was intended to circulate, which actually makes absolute sense because of its foundational parts to it. You see, unlike the rest of Paul's letters, this letter, Ephesians, was not written to address a specific situation. It wasn't about the heresies in the book of Galatians. It wasn't about the immorality in the church of Corinth. It wasn't about the last days with the church of Thessalonica. But it was written to reveal to the church the riches of their salvation in Jesus Christ and how it impacts their daily lives. And so, if it circulated amongst other churches, awesome. If it was just the church of Ephesus, awesome. But you know what? No matter what, is the message of this letter is not specific to a particular church, unlike many of the other letters. This was not specific to a particular church, a specific time, a specific people, a specific culture, but it is a beautiful description of the timeless reality of our Christian faith and how to live in light of the calling that Christ has called upon us. You know, this book can easily be divided into about seven components, seven different pieces. The first part is chapter 1, basically. If you look at verse 3, it says, "Blessed," chapter 1, verse 3, "Blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessings in the heavens in Christ." So the first component that Paul is trying to talk about in the church in the book of Ephesians is the amazing riches of God's salvation in Christ Jesus to us and to His church. So the first thing Paul talks about is the amazing riches to us and his church in Christ. The second thing, is that what those riches have done to us through Christ. Basically, what he has taken us from and brought us into. That's the second thing, that those riches are to us because we're no longer sinners, we're no longer foreigners, but we're now part of the family. If you will look at chapter 2, verse 4, he says, but God, chapter 2, verse 4, but God, who is abundant in mercy because of his great love that he has for us, made us alive with the Messiah, even though we were dead in trespasses. By grace, you have been saved. So the first part is amazing riches in Christ. The second one is, is what he has done for us. And then the next one, the next part that Paul lets us know about in the book of Ephesians is we have been adopted into a family. In verse 2, chapter 2, verse 19, it reads this. Chapter 2, verse 19. So then, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of God's household. You are no longer foreigners and strangers, but you are now part of a family. You see this whole concept of Lone Ranger Christians, and you can do anything you want as a Christian. Not anything. You can do it on your own. That is an absolute lie of the enemy and a lie of the world. I don't know about you, but you know where the greatest challenge to my Christian walk has been? It hasn't been out in the world. Because me and Jesus can make it along perfectly fine out there. You know where my greatest challenge has come? Is when I have to live by you all the time. Where you have to see the ugly part of me, right? You have to see my lack of self-control. Where you have to see all the bits and pieces that I don't want you to see. But also, Val, I get to see where you are. I get to see the ugliness in you. I get to see the ugliness in Jay. I get to have to put up with you guys, and you get to put up with me. And Long, we get to rub each other and to grow each other and to mature each other. Listen, this is easy. This is another thing. That is why 1 John says very, very clearly, you say you love me, well, you better love my people too.
Yeah, yeah.
Because if you don't love my people, you don't love me. This is where we visually see if we really do love God. And so we're part of a church. We've been brought into a family. You're not alone. You're not alone. You're not supposed to. You know what? This Lone Ranger Christian, I'm thinking, you know what? How terrible. The whole part of, one of the main parts of being a Christian is being a part of a family. I'm 3,000 miles removed from my biological family, but yet my family sits in front of me every Sunday. What a beautiful thing. That's the third thing. The fourth thing that Paul talks about in the book of Ephesians, by the way, this is just an introductory sermon. We're going to get into deep into this the rest of the few weeks. The fourth thing is the need for unity and godly leadership to grow the church and to mature disciples of Christ. Chapter 4, verses 4 through 5. There is one body, one spirit, just as you were called in one hope at your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in all. Unity. Verse 11. And he personally gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, for the training of the saints, the work of ministry, to build up the body of Christ until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of God's Son, growing into a mature man with a full stature, with a stature measured by Christ's fullness. And if I keep on going on, it's just so you're no longer tossed around like little children, back and forth to every wind of doctrine, until you basically grow into maturity in a united body. Listen, me and James and Jim's responsibility is not to go out and lead people to Christ. Our responsibility is not to do your job. We are to equip you. We are to prepare you. That when you go to your business places, when you go to your families, when you go to your friends, that you don't just preach the gospel, but that you live the gospel. And to do it as a body. Another part. Another fifth thing that the book of Ephesians teaches us is how the riches of salvation, the greatness and the magnitude of our salvation should, not might, but should impact our lives and our relationships. Verse 8 of chapter 5. For you once were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Me and Randy were listening to a sermon by Charles Price while we were doing some work in here and everything. We tried to listen to a sermon by another guy, but he was talking about all this other stuff that was just waving over my head, so I just turned it off. And everything, and he talked about how he used to do these youth camps. And one day, he was helping a kid that just got there bring his stuff into his room, and as he was walking with him, he said he normally didn't do this because they had a lot of Christians and a lot of people that came that weren't Christians that came to camp. But he just happened to ask this one kid, and he said, "Are you a Christian?" And he said, Yes, I am." He said, "Oh, that's great. How long?" He said, "For about 2 years now." He said, "Well, that's awesome." And that's pretty much where he left it. But as the week went on, this kid, teenager, whoever, was totally not demonstrating Christ-like attitude. Apparently, actually, he was the one causing most of the problems they constantly had to get onto and all this other stuff. Finally, he called the kid into his room and said, "Can I ask you a question?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Are you a Christian?" And he said, "Yes, you've already asked me that." And he said, "For how long?" And he said, "For 2 years, you've already asked me that." And he said, "Well, why do you keep asking me these same questions?" And he said, "Well, can you do," and then Charles Price asked, he said, "Son, can you do me a favor? If someone asks you that again, if you are a Christian, can you do me a favor?" And the kid said, "Yes." He said, "Can you tell them this? Mind your business. Can you just tell them to mind their business?" And he goes, "Yeah, I can do that, but why?" He said, "Because we're trying to do something here. We're trying to show people that Jesus works. We're trying to show people that Jesus transforms and changes lives, and you are messing that up." He said at the last day of the rally, last day of the camp, the kid got up there, and they said, "Does anybody have any testimonies to share?" He said the kid stood up, and Charles said, "Oh my goodness, what are you going to say? He's going to tell everybody what I said to him and everything like that." And he said he got up there and he just broke down. And he told about the exchange that he had with me and how he went back to his room and he went down on the side of his bed and he was just broken. And he said he realized that he was getting in the way because of his lifestyle. He was living as a child of darkness even though he's a child of light. The world needs to see in us. That's what the book of Ephesians needs to say. If you have been impacted by the magnitude of salvation, it will leave a mark. And otherwise, when it doesn't, the world says, "Why do I need Jesus? Because he doesn't work." He changes lives. But when they don't see us as children of light, they do not see how the gospel impacts lives. They don't see the magnitude. They don't see the freshly cleaned asphalt from the power sweep. Yeah. Even though those darn trucks come right back in. The next part is instructions on how to overcome the enemy. Because you know what? We are children of light who walk in a world of darkness. And the enemy tries his best, and our flesh rears its ugly head all the time. And we need instructions on how to overcome the enemy. And that's why verse 6, chapter 10 says this: finally, be strong. Be strengthened by the Lord and by his vast strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the tactics of the enemy. Like the other scriptures where it says, we do not battle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and the rulers of the air. You see, when Val or Audrey or Randy rubs me in the wrong way, it's not them rubbing me in the wrong way. It's either my flesh or it's the envy using them. Notice I said it could be me or them. Most of us just want to say it's them. And it's, that would be an easy thing because I know how Val is. Henry. The last thing, and this is kind of intermixed all throughout. The rest of these are kind of divided. This one is intermixed all throughout it, and that is prayers from a man with a pastor's heart who desires his listeners to grasp the riches of their salvation and overcome the world through Christ. Ephesians chapter 1, 15 through 23. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21 are prayers for the people he loves. That they will experience all those things I just listed. They will know the magnitude of their salvation. I will be praying as we go through this series the same thing that Paul is praying in the first verses that we just read. That you will know the hope, and me, that we will know the hope of God's calling. That we will know the magnitude that the God of all creation has called you to be his child. That's the hope of our calling. I will be praying that you and I will know the magnitude again that the God of all creation has called you to be his child. The second thing I will be praying, that the glorious riches of his inheritance, that we will know the glorious riches of his inheritance among us. That all is ours since we are his child. Everything that Jesus has access to, we have access to. Yes. Jesus even said that we would do greater things than he. But yet do we? And it's usually because we don't know the power button in the skid stirs there. Right. The third thing I'm praying for you and I is that the immeasurable greatness, the magnitude of his power to us that believe, that we will grasp the power and authority that we have in our lives through Jesus Christ, and hence, as children of God, that we have the power to overcome this world and to see his kingdom come in our lives and the lives of our community. How dare we live mediocre and average Christian lives when we have so much available to us?
Yes. Yes.
I do not want any of you to enter into heaven and go, "Whew, I really missed it, didn't I?" I don't believe you will, because I believe when you get to heaven, it's all going to have a mind of Christ, but I'm using that as an illustration. You know what? I don't want you to go this time next year and look past them this year and just go, "Man, I missed out on a whole year. I missed out on several years." Many of you have missed out on several years in mediocrity and average Christian lives, not realizing you're sitting in a skid steer and you're satisfied, but there's a power button right there. And instead of just stirring up dust, you can swoop it up.
Amen.
Yeah. Let us no longer live mediocre and average Christian lives, which I would actually argue is no Christian life. But I live a life that is sold out to the one who has transformed us from darkness into light. And thus, as Paul says in Romans, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, so that we can do so much more than we can think and imagine through his power, his authority, and through his Son, Jesus Christ. You know, I do not want this morning to begin with the first chapter, because I want to devote enough time to really getting into these passages, breaking down each of those different six components or seven components that I talked about. So I will close this morning with a challenge. There are only six chapters in the book of Ephesians. Six. That's it. Let's do some math really quick, okay? Somebody help me here. 23. Remember that number. Now add 22 to 23. Somebody tell me that number.
45.
45? We're all right there? Okay. Keep 45 in your mind. Now add 21 to that.
66.
66, I think, right?
66?
All right.
I'm going to work to the Bible.
Yes, 66. Now add to 66, 32.
98.
98. Okay, now we're getting into three digits, so this gets harder. All right. 98. Now add 33. 131, right?
131.
131? All right, now add to 131, 24.
145?
145? No, 155. 155. 155 verses. That's not a lot. 155 verses. My challenge to you this week is we will be going through the book of Ephesians all the way to December 14th. My birthday. Just throw that out. All the way to December 14th. All right? My challenge to you is this. Every week between now and then, read the book of Ephesians at least once. 155 verses. Just read it once. I challenge you to read it more. To read more. But I don't want you to do this. I don't want you to open up your Bible right before you go to bed and just, children, obey your parents and the Lord because this is right. I'm your father and mother, which is the first command with a promise that he may go with you and that you may have a lot of wives and life. Okay, check that off. No. I want you to do what the book, what the Old Testament says, and that is meditate on it. Yeah. And the word meditate in Hebrew actually means to chew the cud. All right, it means basically when a cow basically spits up the food and eats it back and then chews it all up and he takes his time to enjoy it. All right, I want you to go through that book of Ephesians by going, children, obey your parents in the Lord because it is right. Okay, all right, let's think about that. Honor your father and mother. What does that mean for me when I'm 50? Because let me just let you know this. That commandment was not given to 8-year-olds. We teach it in our churches all the time, but that is not right.
Given to the church.
It was given to adults. Yeah. It was given to mature people. An 8-year-old these days knows more how to honor their mother and father better than some of us that are 30 and 40 and 50.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just let that sit. We'll talk more about that. My challenge to you is to read those chapters, to read those 6 chapters, those 155 verses, and to meditate on it, chew it, just soak it up, enjoy it. Read it more than once. Look at how it impacts your life now. The beautiful thing about the book of Ephesians is I guarantee you, there is a situation you're going through right now that there is at least one verse in the book of Ephesians. As you're reading it, you're going to go, whoa, whoa, that helps. I guarantee you, if you will read it through, it is so varied and so beautiful that it will impact you sometime this week. And when you come next week, that's right. I guarantee you, that if you come here next week and you listen to me preach through Ephesians chapter 1, you will get more out of it than any sermon that I've ever preached. Because you come with your heart prepared.
Yes.
We're going to sing, Count Your Many Blessings, I think, right? Which is Oh, Come Thy Fount of Every Blessing. Which is a beautiful song, because that's what the Ephesians chapter 1 is all about. The riches and the blessings of Christ. And here's what I challenge you to respond this morning. You can stand. My challenge to you is this, not just to read the book of Ephesians, but as we sing, Come Thy Fount of Every Blessing, I want you to celebrate these blessings.
Yes.
Come down to the altar if you want. You know what? The altar is just not time for us to come down and say, woe is me. If you need to do that, great. God loves people that say, woe is me, because you know what he does with those people? He transforms them and says, oh, what a great God. But it's also a place for you to come and just bow and just say, oh, how great are you, God, for your many blessings and riches. Maybe this morning for the first time, you want to cry out to Jesus and say, man, I never realized the riches of Jesus Christ. And for the first time this morning, Jeremiah, I want to take the hand of Jesus.
Yeah.
Just come and take my hand, and I'll lead you to Jesus. Holy Father, we pray that we would just be impacted by the book of Ephesians. We pray that if there's anybody here that does not know your Son, that they will not leave this place without knowing the blessings that comes from saying yes to you and no to ourselves. Let us know the fount of every blessing, isn't it? We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Please come as God leads.